innovation perspective. It really gives companies the ability to rapidly develop, test, launch applications. Competition is high at the moment. So a lot of companies, if they want to stay relevant in the market, being agile, being flexible is key nowadays. But why do we need architecture? Because it's very easy to get started, right? You just go to the Azure portal and you click on some services, you deploy something, and you have an application running. It's very easy. And that's also the counterpart of it. That's also why it is so very important that you have a good architecture in place. If you just let your developers or your administrators or your business spin up a lot of services, it will result in a badly managed cloud environment, including lots of very expensive services like Cosmos DBs, AKS clusters, you name it. What you also see is that cloud technologies are distributed. So you need a lot of different software components to set up an actual application. And that also means that you have to approach it from a different angle than when you create traditional on-premises applications, for instance. And what also should not be overlooked is that security is something that is very important nowadays. You really need to secure all your services by default and make sure that they are safe and that your data is safe as well. And that's all part of setting up a good architecture from the technical perspective. So what does that really mean? What makes a very good architecture nowadays? You really need to think adaptive and elastic. It should be able to support growth of users, but also of services, of data, without any drop of performance. And you also need to treat your servers as disposable objects. You need to make sure that you use composable objects instead of fixed components. But they should always be consistent and tested. So that's also what makes up a very good architecture. And what is very important, automate everything that you can automate. Make that part of your architecture as well. And lastly, optimize for costs. Start with that by designing your architecture and always design everything with security in mind. But architecture is not only about technology. It's also about people, and it's also about culture. And that is very important. And successful cloud transformation or a successful cloud implementation starts with leadership that is pushing that cloud transformation from the top to the bottom. And it starts with technology that is pushing that cloud transformation from the bottom to the top. And you need all these different aspects. A couple of years ago, when I started to work on cloud projects for bigger enterprises, I was under the impression that if you implement cloud transformations bottom up, from the bottom up approach, it will eventually fit into the organization, and the organization will also adapt to that. But to be honest, that is not really the case. If you don't have leadership that really adapts that cloud transformation, that is really willing to push that cloud transformation across the whole organization, eventually it will fail. So you really need leadership. You really need the people that are working with it, and you need the technology. And if you then look at the cloud adaption lifecycle, you will see those three angles popping up here as well. A successful cloud transformation always involves these three elements. It involves people, it involves the process, and the technologies. And it's all about how these three processes or these three elements interact with each other. The people do the work, the processes make the work more efficient, and technology helps the people to do their tasks and helps to automate the processes. So you really really need these three elements for a in a successful cloud adoption lifecycle. And it starts with setting up a strategy. When you define your cloud business strategy, you should really consider, what is the business impact? What is the cost? What is the performance that we need? What is the global reach? The most successful cloud adoption journeys start with business outcome in mind, backed up by the financial part of it and the supporting part of it. And by establishing clear business outcomes, you really drive transparency and engagement across your organization. So first you identify that business value, the business value opportunities, and then you select the right technology. And then when you have selected the right technology, you implement the first application. And this is really key to learning and testing across your organization. And you use that application to start your cloud journey. And you use a two-phased approach to select that first application. First, you look at the business criteria. You look at an application that is currently in operation and where the owner of that application has a strong need or a strong motivation to move to the cloud. That is very important. And then you look at the technical criteria, select a small application, an application that has minimal dependencies and that can be moved easily to the cloud, because you want that first, the first step in your journey to be a success. So start small, start with the best fitted application, with the application that is best, which has the minimum dependencies and can be moved to the cloud easily. And when you define that strategy, make sure that you have a team that consists of business leaders, financial leaders, people from the operational part, but also from the application part. Make sure that they are all in that team. And make sure that they develop a very clear business justification. And in that justification, in that business case, there should be elements about costs, scalability, productivity, and reliability. Make sure that that is all part of that strategy plan. And once you have that strategy in place and your organization is going to move forward in that cloud adoption, the planning phase comes in. And this is also really key to success, to a successful cloud transformation. Your organization already has a lot of technology in place. That is the case for most enterprises and most organizations. So you really must understand what the current state of that IT landscape is. And then develop a prioritization plan to move to the cloud. And here you focus on two main aspects. First, rationalization of your IT assets. Understand the current collection of that IT assets. Know how that IT landscape looks like. Do an assessment on your IT landscape, on your infrastructure landscape, but also on your application landscape. And when you have a clear view of what is actually going on inside of your enterprise or your organization, and to be honest, there are a lot of organizations that don't really know what is actually going on inside their IT landscape or what type of applications they are actually running. Most organizations don't really have a clue what is going on. So make sure that you have that complete overview. And once you have that, then take a look at your applications. What are you going to do? Are you going to rehost applications, refactor them, rebuild them, replace them with out-of-the-box applications, SaaS applications, for instance? And once you have that clear view, then it's time to create your adoption plan, your cloud adoption plan. Develop a plan where prioritized workloads are defined and aligned with your business outcomes. Make the connection with that business outcomes that you define in your strategy part. So now you have a business plan in place, you have a strategy in place, and now it's time to really get something going on inside your organization. And be aware of the fact that a cloud transformation is really a strategic change inside your organizations, and it really requires involvement from all aspects of the organizations, the business, decision makers, end users, IT, your IT professionals, they all need to be part of this. So how are you going to get this or get your organization and your people ready for this journey? First, define the skills that are needed. Create a skills readiness assessment plan and define the current skills that you already have in your organization, and then address the gaps that you still have. And then make sure that you train your people to be ready for this change. Train them on the technical part, but also on a DevOps and an Agile part, because a cloud transformation involves DevOps and Agile practices. And define support needs. Make sure that everyone is supported to make this transition to the cloud. Next, create the landing zone. And this is your technical blueprint that you are creating. This is your infrastructure foundation. These are your security policies, your security measurements. These are cost measurements that you already have in place. And define that foundation where you're going to deploy your applications on. And I cannot stress this enough, design this with security and cost effectiveness in mind. And this is the first step in actually migrating some assets or services to the cloud. Whether this is a lift or shift migration, or this is really a rebuild or a rehost or a cloud native approach, you need this step. This is a very important one. So once you have your landing zone in place, people are trained, you have clear business outcomes. Now it's time to really migrate something to the cloud. And there are two different approaches to this. You have the cloud migration, which is actually a lift and shift migration. You pick up some servers, you move them to the cloud. And this is often the fastest and most agile approach in short terms for organizations. And I would not recommend this, and only recommend this in cases where you have, for instance, a data center that is going to be shut down. You have requirements for licensing that you cannot solve on-premises environments, and so on. And or there are cases where you want to really change something inside your organization and you want to move rapidly to the cloud to really force your organization in moving to it. Then a lift and shift migration can be a good approach as well. But this should never be your end state. When you are migrated to the cloud or shifted to the cloud, make already plan the next steps to really create a cloud native service of that VMs that you are running there with applications on top of it, because it's not going to give the best benefits for using cloud services. A VM in the cloud is still a VM. It doesn't use any other services, any other cloud native services. It's just running on that VM. So the other step is really cloud innovation. This is where you really are going to modernize your applications, rebuild your applications, use cloud native services, use serverless components, use microservices, use containers, you name it, databases, all PaaS services. This is really where the innovation happens. And this approach also involves incorporating DevOps and software development lifecycle approaches. And this is really part of that cloud native strategy or that cloud native technology approach that you take. So you have some applications in the cloud, and now it's time to manage them. And the process of adopting that cloud journey, that cloud transformation is a journey and it is not a destination. And along the way, in this process, you will see that new requirements pop up, new business requirements, new security requirements, new technology requirements. And you need to be capable of adding and embedding those requirements in your organization as well. And this is an ongoing process. This is an iterative process. This will never stop. Every time when you move or deploy new applications to the cloud, new requirements will pop up. And that is also a good thing. That means that your organization keeps evolving and is agile enough to add that add that change to the organization. So when you're managing your cloud platform, it's very important that you first define the governance solutions that you need, your business needs, implementing security, agility, scalability, and the five real disciplines of cloud governance are, in fact, cost management, security baselining, resource consistency, identity baseline, and deployment acceleration. That should be all part of defining that governance solutions. What are the guardrails that you need to have in place? How do you make everything secure by default? How do you embed that in your full software development lifecycle? How do you achieve the right balance between setting up and maintaining a secure and stable platform, and on the other hand, give your developers the freedom to innovate, to experiment, and to do things at their own pace, and also being capable of deploying their own services. That is always a very difficult thing to decide on. What is the right balance? And once you have those governance solutions defined, it's time to implement them and do this in an automated way. Make sure that it's part of your DevOps strategy, that it's part of your applications, of your landing zones, that it's all rolled out automatically, that all security is embedded, and so on. Make sure it's part of your DevOps pipelines, and also that it is known by all the architects that are working in your organization or on the project. And once these governance solutions are implemented, you really need to allow it to evolve and to grow over time. You need to adapt to your organizational changes, your organizational needs. And here, automation is key as well. Make sure that you set everything up that it is flexible enough to enable that change and to enable that evolving journey. And make sure monitoring, logging, budgets, cost effectiveness, that it's all taken care of automatically. And if you now look at the Microsoft approach, and you will see that the Microsoft Cloud Adoption Framework is also very much in line with this cloud adoption lifecycle. The Cloud Adoption Framework is also gathered around people, process, and technology. For the people part, documentation is provided. A set of best practices is provided. How to train your people, how to enable an agile environment. For the process part, a lot of tooling and templates are available that you can use and you can download from the Cloud Adoption Framework website. And of course, the technology part is also covered, also with templates, also with best practices, and also with documentation. And if you look at how the Cloud Adoption Framework is set up, you will see that it is split up according to that cloud adoption lifecycle. Microsoft also has a strategy part where you define your business justification and the expected outcome. There's also a planning phase, a ready phase where you implement that cloud landing zone or that landing zone. The migration part, where you modernize your workloads, where you migrate your workloads, and where you're going to develop new cloud native services. There is a governance part where you manage your environments. And at last, there are also, from the people perspective, also a lot of best practices offered as well. And what Microsoft is trying to achieve here as well, and what I also mentioned in one of the previous slides, how to find the right balance to a controlled and stable environment, a stable cloud environment, but also being agile and flexible enough to enable speed and to get results quickly. So let's take a quick look at what the cloud adoption has to offer. I will pick some parts out of it. I will not show all of it. You can do that at your own pace. So if you go to the docs.microsoft.com website and you search for Cloud Adoption Framework, you will see that you will land on this page. And here you will see that the Cloud Adoption Framework offers a set of guidance based on these pillars. And if you look at the Get Started page, you will find a lot of valuable scenarios that you can pick from. If you look at your organization, what is the scenario that you are going to cover? Are you going to migrate SAP environments to Azure? Is that the scenario? Are you going to look for a modern application platform scenario? Are you really going to migrate or modernize your applications? Or maybe you want a hybrid or a multi-cloud adoption scenario. Maybe you have some on-premises data center or you have other clouds that you are leveraging as well. So here you can find a good getting started guide based on the scenario that fits your organization. And if we look at a different phase here in the migrate part, you will see that there is a migration guide that you can use as well. And in that migration guide, you will see that they have it is split up in an assess phase, a deployment phase, a release phase, and Microsoft is offering different tools for that phase. If we look at the assess workload phase, you will see that Microsoft is pushing, of course, their native tooling, the Azure Migrate tool, which you can really use to assess your VMs and to also migrate that VMs to Azure as well. And there is a lot of information about cost management and all sorts of recommended content that you can really dive into if this is the scenario that you're going to use for your organization. If you look at deploy workloads, you will see that there is native migration tooling, but Microsoft also offers or gives an overview of the third-party migration tools that you can use that are also capable of migrating your workloads to Azure. If you want to set up your project management part, there is an overview of the different tooling that you can use here and how to set up for DevOps and how to set up your DevOps environment with a lot of quick starts references to it. So there's a lot of tooling and a lot of information that you can use to really get started. But Microsoft, instead of just documents and links and information, there are also a couple of assessments that you can go through. And for the Cloud Adoption Framework, for instance, there is the Cloud Journey Tracker that you can use. Let me open one that I already filled in. There it is. So you can use this assessment to really look at where you are at the moment in your cloud adoption journey or in your cloud journey. Let's see what it has to offer. There are a lot of questions that you can answer. How would you describe your cloud journey? And here you select what is the scenario that you're going to cover here? Are you going to deploy VMs? Are you going to deploy multiple workloads? So what are the areas that you are interested in? And you can just fill in what you are actually trying to achieve there. What are the motivations of your organization? So this is really also on the strategy part. What are you going to do to create your skill readiness plan? All sorts of questions that you can answer, but also that give you a lot of ideas and insights in what is actually needed to start that cloud journey. And once you have answered all these questions, you will get a report out of it. And in that report, you will see that there are some guidance results for you that you can follow. See if it's opening up now. Here you will see your results. Where is your organization at this moment. How is your strategy? Is it already good enough to start that cloud journey? Maybe you need to add some more to it. What is it? This is all centered around that items or around that pillars of that cloud adoption framework. So a quick summary, I've showed you the guidance documents that you can use in your cloud journey. We briefly looked at that Azure migration guide and what Azure has to offer from that perspective. And last, we looked at the assessments of the cloud journey tracker. Highly recommended to fill this one in for your organization. This really gives you a lot of valuable insights. Okay. So the next part of this session, Microsoft, instead of just focusing on that strategy part and the process part and the people and the culture part of it, it also gives you a lot of valuable guidance about building applications, designing applications, building them, improve security, scalability, reliability, really build applications that are distributed and ready to run in cloud services. And for this, they have divided the well-architected framework in 5 different pillars. It starts with cost optimization, and these are really important considerations that can help you to achieve the business outcomes or the objectives, but also the technical objectives. It's really about reviewing your cost principles, how to create budgets and alerts, how to develop your cost model, and there's also a cost optimization checklist. The next one is operational excellence, managing that the cloud platform, your operation processes. Keep your application running in your production environment. It focuses in on how to implement DevOps practices, automated deployments, reliable deployments which can easily roll back and forth if needed. And it offers guidance about monitoring and diagnostics inside your cloud environment. Next one is performance efficiency. Can your workload scale accordingly? Design patterns to really build scalable applications. Best practices around auto scaling, setting up CDNs, data partitioning, caching, all sorts of guidance patterns are offered there and provided there as well. There is a pillar around reliability, because we know that in the cloud failures will happen. It always does. But how can you set up your applications and your services that they are capable of overcoming those failures easily and without big disruptions. And last is security. Very important. How can you protect your applications? How can you protect your data from threats at all costs? And besides that guidance, those patterns that Microsoft has offered from the well-architected framework, there's always also a couple of tooling that they are providing. And these are available from inside of the Azure portal. You have the Azure Advisor, which is your personalized tool in the Azure portal that helps you follow the best practices around the well-architected framework. It really analyzes your current landscape, your current services in Azure, and it gives advice about these services and also about the 5 pillars of the well-architected framework. And based on that, it recommends solutions for you that can really help to improve your security, improve your scalability and your performance and so on. And part of the Azure Advisor tooling is Advisor Score, really a core feature of Azure Advisor. And that aggregates all the recommendations that Azure Advisor gives you into one overview. And this score also helps you to take the necessary steps to overcome all these challenges and these flaws in your environment. And I will show you these tooling later on in the demo. And that is now. Okay. Let me open up the well-architected framework. One minute. Let's start with the assessment that also comes with the well-architected framework. So let me go back to the assessment page. Here you see that there is also an Azure well-architected review that you can use to examine that workload. Let's open the one up that I already filled in for this example. There we go. And this is a very, very big one. I only selected the security part of it, but it has questions around all these five pillars that you can answer and to get a really good overview of what is going on in your environment. And also how you handle these from a process and a people perspective. So all these questions, you can go through them. Do you already have anything in place for managing identities, for instance? How are you monitoring security-related events in your workloads? What are you now actually doing with keys, secrets, and certificates? How do you manage those? So you can give answers based on your current environment. And then after answering all those questions, you will get guidance on how to implement additional security measurements in my case. For instance, I have a lot to do on the security side of my organization. But these insights can also come from inside of the Azure portal, and I will show you that. And this inside the Azure portal is of course based on what is actually running in your Azure environment. It scans that using the resource graph. So if you want to open the advisor, you can just search for advisor, click on it, and then you will see that you get an overview page, which is based on these five pillars of the Azure Well-Architected Framework. And as you can see, I get a lot of security recommendations, which is not a good case because I stress in almost all my slides, and I mention in all my slides that you really need to implement security by default. So I have a lot to do, but you see that it's scanning my environment. It's looking at what type of resources there are deployed, and then it gives me recommendations based on these resources and based on my settings. For instance, I have a storage account, and I don't have Azure Defender enabled on it. I have three types of storage accounts. And what you can see here is that you can enforce by using policies to enable Azure Defender from here. So this is all Azure policy driven, all resource graph driven. And you can also view the policy file, the definition file, if you want to. So if you want to add this to your DevOps pipelines, you can just copy this and paste that in your DevOps environment. And then the next time that you roll out that new service or that new storage account, Defender will be enabled by default. You can assign it in here. So you can assign this policy, and here it gives you the ability to, let's take the good one. Also to enforce this already on your environment. And if you want to look at the query that it's using here, it is using, and this is what it's using underneath. This is what Azure Advisor is using. You can run a query and you will get the exact same results. So what is Advisor Score? Still a preview feature, but here you can see that This is also gathered around these five pillars. You also can drill down into the exact same recommendations in here, and you get a score. What is your score at the moment? And here it says, if you have a score of 100%, you know that you have followed all the Azure best practices. So I have a lot of stuff to do after this session to secure my environment. Okay, so a quick recap of this demo. We looked at one of the Azure well-architected review that you can use and that you can use to assess your current landscape. We looked at Azure Advisor and how this is recommending a lot of measurements from the Azure portal based on your current landscape, and the Advisor score, which is still in preview, which gives you a score, which gives you a very good overview of what is how secure and how performant and scalable are you now at the moment. Okay, so the last topic of this session, besides guidance, documents, assessments, patterns, Microsoft is also offering you landing zones, and you can use these landing zones as a reference for your own solutions. And they're basically infrastructure as code files that you can deploy to your Azure environment. And those landing zones are gathered around the following design areas. The first one is your enterprise agreement, your Azure AD tenants, what is the commercial relationship with Microsoft, and how is your organization using Azure? What are the different business units that are using Azure? What is that hierarchy? The next one is identity and access management. How is your Azure AD designed? How do you implement role-based access control? How do you enforce separation of duties? How do you implement your platform operation and management? How is key management enabled in your organization? Do you Azure Key Vault, for instance, certificates, how do you manage that? How are your access roles? How are they assigned to your application owners, to your administrators, and so on? That's also part of it. Next is management groups and subscription organization, very important one, especially in enterprises. How is your management group structure set up? How do you set this up inside of an organization? What is a logical way of doing that? How do you set up your subscription? How do you manage those subscriptions? How do you set up billing and budgets for those subscriptions? A very critical part of enterprise scale cloud environments as well. Next, management and monitoring. How do you set up your monitoring solutions? Where do you host them? Where do you position them? How do you take care of operational tasks like patching, backups? How do you use monitoring and logging solutions in Azure? Where do you position them? And how do you connect to all your different applications from that? There is also guidance on how to set up your network topology. How do you set up a hybrid connection? How do you use ExpressRoute, VPNs? How do you put that inside of your landing zones combined with policies and so on? Business continuity and security, governance, compliancy. How do you set up your policies? On what level do you set up the policies? Do you do that on management group level, on subscription level, on resource group level? How do you deploy all those services? How do you deploy those policies? You have the platform automation, DevOps part. How do you set up your pipelines? How do you set up an end-to-end DevOps experience with security in mind, fully automated? So these are really the parts that are added to that landing zone that you can use as a reference for your solutions. And Microsoft created 4 landing zone references for you that you can use. It starts with the enterprise scale foundation. It is really for applications that want to migrate their application portfolios. It enables organizations to start small. It's the smallest landing zone that there is, and also set up hybrid connectivity with on-premises data centers. That is also part of this landing zone. The next one is enterprise scale. This is based on the foundation landing zone, the enterprise scale foundation, and also allows organizations to start small. And this is really aimed at organizations that have small IT teams to manage the cloud environment. Next one, enterprise scale with Azure VWAN. And this is also for hybrid connectivity, application portfolios, but with ExpressRoute or VPN. This is really based on a architecture with Azure Virtual WAN network topology. And the next one, and this is the one that I see the most implemented in enterprises, the enterprise scale with hub and spoke architecture. And this also incorporates hybrid connectivity and application scenarios, but it's based on the hub and spoke architecture where you have one hub with a lot of centralized services and you have all sorts of spokes gathered around it that use that management services as well. And that is also the landing zone that I'm going to show you now. So let's go to the GitHub repo of the enterprise scale landing zones. So if you go to the GitHub repo, you will see a lot of documentation around these enterprise scale landing zones. You can also sign up for community calls. They are organizing community calls once a month, I guess. And there you can get information about all the new stuff they've put into, but they also ask for feedback about around that landing zones. There is a user guide that you can use, and these here you can see the 4 different reference implementations based on the slide that I showed before. And let's open up the AdventureWorks reference because this is the one that is using that hub and spoke topology. They also have a nice button to deploy this to Azure. Don't do this. Not recommended. Because when you do this, this will get deployed. A lot of services, a lot of connections, a lot of policies based on this architecture. And I will zoom it in for a bit. This is really a reference architecture. Don't deploy this for your customers. And I don't recommend deploying this in your own Azure environment as well, because your credits will be spent very soon. But it is a very good reference architecture because it really gives you an overview of how to set up those management groups and how to set up the management subscription, which is basically the hub in this case. How to set up Azure, where do you set up Azure Monitor? Where do you set up your Key Vault? Where do you set up your storage accounts? Not Azure Monitor, because that's an Azure-based service. It is accessible from all your other services. But what do you do with all your connectivity items? Put them in a separate subscription in this case. Now, that can be a very logical way and a very clear way to set up your architecture. There is in this case a separate identity subscription. In this solution, they are using domain controllers and Active Directory installed on VMs. Maybe there is a hybrid connection with Azure Active Directory as well, but it gives you a reference on how to set up it. Maybe if you have a hybrid deployment, for instance, or you want to move your Active Directory to the cloud with a lift and shift migration. And here you have the different spokes. This is one of the spokes, which is based on an application scenario. It has an application gateway in it. It has an app, a web app. It also uses a couple of VMs. This application, it uses a data lake. So this really gives a very good overview on how to set up that architecture. So quick recap for this last demo. I showed you the GitHub repo and where you can get those landing zones and a lot of information about these landing zones. You should definitely check this out. And we looked at that AdventureWorks reference case and how you can use this as a base or an example for your own architecture solutions. So before we end, I have a couple of key takeaways that I want to repeat after this session. If you really want to drive a successful cloud transformation, make sure that leadership is involved, that they know and they are supporting and driving this change across an organization. People and culture are key to success. It's not only about technology. Add security to every layer in your architecture. Otherwise, you get the same advice in your Azure advisor part as I do. Don't do that. Make sure you have security in mind and design everything according to your security organizational security measurements and regulations. Always be aware of the costs. It can blow up easily if you deploy lots of services inside of your Azure environment. I can highly recommend the Microsoft Learn modules around the Cloud Adoption Framework and the Azure Well-Architected Framework. I learned a lot from it, so highly recommend it. Use tools like Azure Advisor and Azure Advisor Score. Look at your environment. What is actually going on? And how can you create better scalable products, better secure services and applications? Use these tools to actually know what is going on around your environment. That GitHub repo that I showed with the enterprise scale landing zones, this isn't in fact an open source project. Microsoft has open sourced a lot of their services, their applications, but also around Azure. So if you have anything to add, or maybe you have any feedback, or you want to help them to really build up these enterprise scale landing zones, contribute to these open source projects. That will really help. And at last, the landing zones that are provided there are references, not solutions. Don't deploy them one-on-one into your environment, but only take out the parts that you really need for your cloud journey and your cloud environment. That's it. If you have any questions, I'm open for it. Thanks a lot.
I think there are a few questions posted in the chat box.
Okay.
And someone is raising his hand. You can unmute yourself if you want. Yeah.
Hey, Vishnu here.
Hi.
Hi. I just wanted to understand, I mean, are Azure Landing Zone recommended for a greenfield projects, or they can be applied to the existing Azure infrastructure as well?
I don't think they can be applied to existing infrastructures, because okay. I think most existing infrastructure already have a key vault or a VNet or already have log analytics set up, and you don't want to redeploy that. And I don't think it's even possible to redeploy that. So then just take the part out of it that you really need.
Okay, makes sense. Thank you.
Yes, Nalin.
Yeah.
Nalin Upadhyay has raised his hand. Or you can unmute yourself if you are there.
Hello.
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 Yes, Hello? Then you are audible again.
Now you're muted.
Oh, now you're muted. I believe there is one question by Vikramjeet. We had all this demo, right? So are we supposed to log into Azure portal, or this are available on Microsoft site?
The documentation for the cloud adoption framework and the well architected framework that is provided online. Everyone can go to the docs.microsoft.com website and look at these assessments and documentation. The enterprise scale landing zones, you can look at them as well. They are open for everyone. The advisor score and Azure Advisor, those are really tools that are part of the Azure portal. So you need to log in for them.
Hi, this is Muhammad. I have a question. Not question, I need a clarification on that. So the blueprint which we create, that is, we can say as a landing zone where we define all the settings, policies, securities, and we define the management groups, all those things we define in a blueprint. So that's we can consider as a landing zone.
You can, yes.
Okay, and another thing I want to link for that open source, this once in the last session you say you can contribute on the open source contribution on that open source project. So do we have any specific link for that to be, we can go and check that open source projects and we can contribute or we can learn from that projects?
You can go to the GitHub repo of Microsoft. Okay. And I will put that one into the chat. And it just works like any other GitHub environment. Oh, I cannot send any messages in the chat.
Okay.
But there is some issue which it's not enabling in the desktop, but okay. I can do it from mobile. So you can post it to me in the LinkedIn and I will share it.
I can also share my screen once more. Then it's not a very difficult link.
Hi.
Here you go.
My question to you that you have mentioned that now the DevOps and automation is the important part of any cloud migration. So as a Azure architect, how much I need to go to the deep to the Azure DevOps technology like Terraform and Azure DevOps things?
Can you repeat the last part of your question, please?
Yeah, so basically how much deep knowledge we should have for as a Azure architect to learn this technology like DevOps and Terraform?
That depends on the role of the architect in your organization. But if I look at myself, I always make sure that I'm updated with the latest technology. So I know how to create an ARM template. I know I'm not good at Terraform. That's not my cup of tea, but I know on the Microsoft part how to create ARM templates, Bicep templates, and PowerShell scripts, for instance. Because if you don't know what's actually going on, how then you're not capable of really properly designed solutions. That's my opinion.
Okay, and now second, one more question, that now everything is moving to the container technology. So is it like AKS or Kubernetes and other things? So is it also a good strategy that now move to everything on the container things, or still the VM and all these things may be fit for some requirement?
I would not recommend to only go for VMs in the cloud. I know there are always applications that are not suitable for moving to cloud native technologies. But I do recommend every organization to modernize everything that they can modernize, and which has a good business outcome, right? If you need to go for containers, it depends. You also have serverless technology. What is the requirement for the organization? Containers is more expensive than serverless technology. How is your development team organized? Do they know how to use containers? Or do they know how to use serverless technologies? So it really depends on the scenario. But I would not say that you need to move everything to containers now.
Okay, thanks.
Hey, this is regarding the same question, maybe a continuation for that. Shall I ask?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, actually, as I am an administrator from both the database and Azure, so which is the best thing I can learn, because started with on-prem and then VMs, physical on-prem VMs, and then now Azure VMs, and then now it is Kubernetes with Kubernetes cluster containerization. So maybe the requirements will be vary on company to company, the organization to organization. It may vary. But in general, if we are considering what are all the things we can learn from the market perspective.
I think containers is a good thing to learn, because a lot of organizations are using this. I think in the future, more organizations will go towards multi-cloud environments, and then containers will be a big part of that as well, because you can run containers on every cloud, right? So you only have to develop applications once, and then you can deploy them across multiple cloud providers. So that's a good thing. I think containers is good. I think serverless technologies is good. And I believe that every administrator should know something about policies, security, and so on.
Got it. Can we go with the cloud providers, Kubernetes itself, or separate ones? Like for AWS, they are having their own EKS, and then in Azure, they are having the AKS. Google is established Kubernetes with their GKEs. So which is the best we can go with? Because everything can be integrated or incorporated for containers, right? Which is the best option to learn the basics of Kubernetes from our end? As an administrator, I'm asking.
Yeah, difficult one. What you see, what I hear in the market the last year is that all cloud providers are saying managing Kubernetes is way too difficult. So we are moving away from self-management, self-administration of containers, and go to those services, those platform as a service container container providers like AKS and the AWS and Google equivalent of it. But organizations are not there yet. So I think learning Kubernetes administration is a good thing, although it is very difficult.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello, this is Mani here. You mentioned that it is not recommended to deploy the Azure landing page architectures in the environment, right? So if we want to explore the any particular component of the landing page or any particular policy, so is there a way without deploying it?
Taking it out of the enormous policy files that Microsoft provides. Yeah. I'm sorry about that, but that is what it is. I think it's a policy file with hundreds of lines of codes, but yeah, that is how you should handle that, I guess.
Sorry, I can't type a message, but would you publish a recording of this session to view? I missed the beginning. Thank you.
Hey, this is Nikhil. I have a good thing. If a customer wants a cloud adoption decision, so is there any questionnaire or anything Microsoft has published during the requirement gathering process, or any template we need to follow?
There is guidance on that cloud adoption framework website. I'm not sure if there is a assessment for that, but guidance, there is a lot of material around that.
Is there any specifically checklist we can get from the Microsoft portal that we should follow while we are migrating the data?
A migration checklist?
Yeah.
I did not come across that. I'm not sure. I need to look into that. If you want me to look into that, let me know. Maybe you can connect with me offline after this session.
Okay. Thank you.
One more thing. So basically, suppose we have an application, legacy application, and we don't have much scalability or modernization requirement, or right now it doesn't have any business needs to modernize that application, but we need to move this application to the cloud. So what will be the recommended? Do we need to go to the containerize, or simple VM shift will be good for that scenario?
And I think with these requirements that you now give me, I would say go for a VM lift and shift then.
Okay.
Hello, excuse me. So the well-architected framework, we do have a lot of design patterns and different approaches are there, right? Do we have any ARM templates for that, or Terraform samples for that? If we want to deploy
for the design yeah. or deploying those yeah. applications.
Yeah. To modify.
I think I'm not really sure if that's what you're looking for, but I know that enterprise scale landing zones, they also incorporate DevOps pipelines. So how to deploy applications. Maybe you can give that a look. Maybe that's they have what you are looking for, because that's the place where the ARM templates are in that GitHub repo.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, I didn't understand. Did you hear my question about publishing the recording link for that session?
Yes. And I also saw in the chat already that the recording will be published. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, thank you. Sorry, I don't see the chat and I can't publish a question in the chat, so that's why I'm interrupting. Sorry.
And there's also a YouTube link already.
I have a question. Thanks for the session. If an organization wants to move to cloud, what do you suggest? Do you suggest to go with an enterprise agreement, or is a CSP a better choice with respect to cost?
Oh, it depends. You can do both. It's very difficult to give an advice on this. I need some more information about the organization, about the relationship with Microsoft, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay, thank you.
But you can use both.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there a way to get the complete map of our Azure infra?
Complete map?
Yeah.
Hmm. If you look at those, I think if you really want a complete overview of what is going on, you can look at Azure Migrate. They have an assessment in there as well. And I know there are third-party assessment tooling that can give you an overview of your complete infrastructure environment.